comic series on the newspapers in Finland, and it's called Kamala Luonto. It's very, very good. I suggest that you try to find it and see for yourself. But she's my assistant, and I'm really glad to have her here helping me. So for those who don't know me, my name is Anna Vuopala. I work at the Ministry of Education and Culture now 20 years this year, and working on infrastructure issues last 6 years. We are trying to focus attention on it, raise awareness, and provide for incentives for the creative sectors to address these issues in a meaningful way from their own perspective, and also, of course, try to support this development that needs cooperation from so many different parties on different levels, lawyers, technologists, and other experts to work together. So I'm really glad to have this group of people here. Last time we were some 60 people, 60, 70 people, hope to reach the same goal this time. And we have a long line of speakers, so I want to welcome all the speakers for this event. We are getting a state of play on the copyright infrastructure this time, meaning we go into the use cases, the projects that are taking place on national level, and hope to see, you know, what kind of what the experiences are in these particular cases related to IDs, for instance, and sharing of data, and the, what are the requirements for using blockchain, for instance. They are difficult issues, and new technologies are having a completely different, let's say, you know, framework than what we've been used to. So it's really interesting to hear what's going on. So welcome once again. I would like to give the floor now to Benoit Müller, who I know from many years back, also previously before he started with WIPO. So please, for your introductory words, you have the floor, Benoit.
Thank you very much, Anna. Well, let me start by congratulating you, Anna, for, you know, having spearheaded the copyright infrastructure debate and during the Finnish EU presidency, and for organizing this series of workshops, which I think are excellent and very useful. And also to thank you for this opportunity to give some introductory remarks. To be quite brief, I think the copyright infrastructure debate is underpinned by obvious realities and uncertain prospects. What is obvious is that technologies, identifiers, and metadata are the more essential as content becomes digital and global. And that new technologies such as cloud architecture, blockchain, offer new opportunities in this field. What is uncertain is which you know, models, applications, standards, databases, and processes will ultimately prevail and shape the future corporate infrastructure. Whilst history does not allow us to predict the future, it can sometimes and often help us to stay away from past illusions. I think we know that, you know, what technology makes possible will not necessarily happen. What drives the solutions are business requirements. And since the marketplace is the expression of competing interests, there are and will always be different views on what is the ideal solution. So if there is a copyright infrastructure crystal ball, one would have to decipher its answers through the prism of the prisoner's dilemma. That said, we don't want to stay in prison. And what Charles Clarke said during the 1996 diplomatic conference that led to the adoption of the WIPO treaties with respect to technical protection measures and rights management information, his still very famous sentence, "The answer to the machine is in the machine," 25 years later, we know he was right. I think we also know that it is only collectively and through mutual understanding that we can unlock the potential of technology, identifiers and data, and identify what are the win-win solutions for a more efficient creative content ecosystem in the years to come. In order to do that, I think exactly what we do today is the right approach, dialogue. And I did note that Anna, in an article published in IPR Info, did suggest that WIPO could also have some conversations on these topics, which is a thought that we have indeed been entertaining for a while. We also have an initiative called WIPO for Creators, where we will raise awareness of the rights and the processes required for creators to be recognized and fairly compensated. I think that's where I see that we can continue this dialogue in the future. So thank you very much, and very much looking forward to this workshop.
Thank you very much, Benoit, for your interactive words and mentioning all the most important issues here is that how to get the benefit of all of these different elements, let's say, that we already touched upon in the last workshop: identifiers, copyright data, quality data, and then interoperability between all of these systems. How can we get the benefit from them so that everybody wins, or that we get a triple win? And well, we don't have the answer to the crystal ball, let's say, but we are learning probably as we go. So I'm really glad that we have today concrete examples from projects, because the better we get aware of the different problems, we are also finding solutions together to them. I think just to mention the connection that we want to also make is for the European level development. I mean, Finland has not only worked on a national level on these issues, but we brought it up on the EU level as part of the Finnish presidency. And we, of course, hope that this work would then assist the EU Commission in their own work. And after the study that is being commissioned at the moment by the Commission, that they would be then able to take steps ahead as well. So this work will support the work on EU level and also global level, if that would be a decision that member states would like to make. So with these words, I think we are ready to go to the first speaker. I'd like to introduce to you Tor Pettersen from New Internet Media. So please, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. Hello, everybody. I would only look at registration, reporting, and licensing, and to make that happen in 15 minutes is not very easy. But in our world of new internet media, it all starts with registration. Registration in a basic form is our starting point is the same registration and as easy as register your company. And it's let's be honest, to register a copyright is very much like registering a company, because there are splits or shares in a copyright as there is in a company. The biggest difference between registration of a company and registration of a copyright is the speed you will get your dividend, or in copyright cases, the royalties. A company is governed by many, many rules in terms of accounting, etc., as is copyright. However, the transfer of royalties can and should be almost instantaneously, which has been our basis from day one. So you register a copyright uniquely on a special blockchain technology, and that's the only besides transfer of money or royalties that we are using blockchain for. So registration is immutable and with provenance on a blockchain. At the same time, it will also be registered the different shares or splits that a copyright entails. And that is the whole basis for paying royalties. You pay a small amount for each time, which we call nano payment. If we are talking about user-centric licensing, but we also support every other types of licensing, service licensing, because it's basically the same. You register each license. So if a digital service provider, for instance, like Deezer, wants to play a song, it has to give notice that that song is to be played, and that it will pay the fee either directly in a royalty payment there and then, or in a service-oriented royalty payment by, for instance, invoice. This cannot be done on a blockchain. It has to be done on a much, much higher transactions. So we are using a cloud-based database who can handle up to 200 million transactions per second. That will take care of most of the popular licensing today. To be absolutely sure that this license is met or is paid to the copyright owner or the shares or the splits in a copyright owner, it has to be reported. It is reported on a ledger, an Amazon, actually, Sky Ledger, who is queryable. So we can ask in a query language who has played this and that song, where in Brazil, for instance, at a certain time frame. Now, those three different elements of a licensing registration reporting scheme is the core of our solution. Next slide, please. Now, let's look at this more in detail. To uniquely identify a copyright, as of now, we are using, and I'm only talking about musical works at this point, an ISWC. A copyright ID is for both musical works and for masters, that is recordings, as it is for articles, for pictures, for videos, for 3D printing for that matter, or design. It is exactly the same unique identificator element. So basically, a copyright ID is uniquely identifiable over the whole internet, if you like. Now, bearing in mind that our solution is only digital, we are not analog or anyway interfering with the old way of transforming or transporting royalties, if you like. Now, the proof of ownership in a copyright ID is what entitles the holder to receive payment, just as it is in company shares, to receive dividends. In our case, we're talking about royalties. Those royalties are transformed or transported in the form of a token, royalty tokens. Those royalty tokens is just a symbol, because for each royalty token, there is an escrow account that each royalty token equals or parity for €1. So there is no Bitcoin or Ethereum or anything like that. It is, it has real value because each royalty token transferred is equal €1 that resides in a bank. Licensing, I know many of you have followed Björn Ulvaeus' discussions in BPC as president of CSAC. And he's a very, very keen advocate of user-centric licensing. That is, every track or music or piece played entitles one payment. And by using royalty tokens, which is actually divided in 100 million Tor bits, my name is Tor, of course, we have a unique opportunity to transport on a one click, one licensing and one payment basis. And at the same time, this is also reported to the Amazon's QLDB services, which is basically a semi blockchain, but it's immutable, and all transactions are secured in a historic way and can be accessed according to each copyright owner's legal arrangement with their publisher or their music labels or whatever else we are talking about here. So the transport of this is recording and licensing is extremely, in our point of view anyway, efficient, and we are not disruptive. We are disintermediating everybody in the value chain, and we're making actually more efficient. Our motto is more money faster to copyright owners, actually up to 60% more and 26 million times faster. Next, please. So, what is the real deal here actually, or how does this happen? It happens by we are securing an exclusive administration over the copyrights, which we are has been doing for quite some a couple of years already. So when a subscriber wants to listen to a specific song, the digital service provider sends a licensing request to one of our cloud servers based on a serverless infrastructure in the cloud for that particular song. NIM servers will accept the license and inform about the licensing cost. Normally, that is already, these days, is already set up in a legal arrangement with the digital service provider. What it will in the future, that we'll see. The digital service providers will then pay the required cost. That could be, for instance, 0.007 euro cent, hopefully much, much more. And this is a final payment. There is no refundable or anything, which means that we are more than capable to compete with any bank transfer on this level. Plus, it is also saves, for instance, a music label like Sony Music in Japan, the exchange risk and transfer, basically. Now, so NIM will then send the right amount of money in royalty tokens directly to the wallet or the account of each copyright holder according to the number of shares they own. And since Guy is here, I'm going to use his Fallen Angel as an example, which is 25, 25, 50. So Guy will then have his 25% of the Fallen Angels directly into his account. The whole thing here is that Guy can then exchange the royalties into euros on a one-on-one basis, or he can exchange it into or other currency, copyright coins, but more of that on in another forum. So copyright shares are also directly useful in, for instance, you can lease your copyright shares for cash flow in these troubled times when no touring is, for a period of time, get cash for your copyright shares, and you get the royalties transferred into the investors, if you like. You will get your copyright shares and your copyright back after the time period agreed is over. And basically, you have a much more flexibility in handling your copyrights than you had before. I have 45 seconds left, so I think I'll leave it there for questions later. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Thor. This was a very, very good presentation on a very difficult topic. And for most people, I don't know, depends. I don't see the whole list. Blockchain is still a little bit of a technology that not very many know about in detail, but it really, this helped us understand what kind of benefits there really is for the creators from a service like this. What you mentioned there was that this is a new system that would then apply only for new works, more or less. We are not meddling on the old side.
We are also.
So legacy works, yes, and new works would be then part of this system.
We are not doing anything in the old fashioned, for instance, AirPlay or any other. This is pure digital. So there will be, as you know, anybody can withdraw their rights from any collecting societies and put it wherever they want. However, as I mentioned earlier, well, actually it was before I had my presentation, everything we do is not for profit and not, it's a white label. So any collecting societies or PRO can use this technology under their own label.
Thank you very much.
Free of charge.
Yes. How about, do we have any questions for Thor at this moment, or should we go forward? We can also, yes, I see a hand. Please, you have the floor and please introduce yourself.
Hello, this is Ulla-Maija Myllyy from Finland. I'm curious about this thing that, well, when you register to the blockchain somebody's copyright, so and to my understanding the record on the blockchain cannot be changed, so and what happens if there is some error at that stage? So do you have some sort of like dispute resolution system for those kind of claims if somebody makes a mistake at that stage?
Well, you cannot change it, but you can always you can always make a new registration with the correct, and you just archive the old one, which is not correct. Basically something that's quite easy, yes.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Do we have any other questions, or I can't see anyone at the moment? Great, thank you, Thor.
I just want to add one more thing, since I have a little bit more. You mentioned that the old system, you can register each new on a one-on-one basis, but we also have tested registration of several hundred thousand already registered corporates, and 10,000 we batch register in less than 20 minutes. So it's not a game stopper to register old systems.
Yeah, this is probably, thank you very much, and I think this is a very important question to discuss, what we are actually trying to use the technology for, new, old, or both, and how, and it's an interesting starter for discussion. So now I think I give the floor to the next project, D3, and it's Hendrik Trasberg from the Ministry of Justice in Estonia who will start first, and I will ask Maria to put the presentation on.
Thank you very much, Anna, and good afternoon from the surprisingly sunny Tallinn. My name is Hendrik Krasberg, and I'm indeed an IP advisor in the Estonian Ministry of Justice. I would actually like to start by noting that the Estonian government attention towards corporate infrastructure was very much sparked by the proactiveness of our Finnish colleagues, who brought the discussion into the European Council during their presidency. And I think that the momentum that the corporate infrastructure discussions have gained among policymakers in Europe was very strongly impacted by the Finnish proactiveness. So I wanted to start off with a big compliment to Anna and her team. Turning to Estonia, could we go to the next slide? We have indeed recently begun a very interesting project in public-private sector combination related to corporate infrastructure. It's been driven by a number of inefficiencies and challenges that we see with content industries in the digital sphere. Among else, it's evident that the regulatory regime is more and more expecting that the content sharing platforms and other intermediaries on the internet would have knowledge on who owns which rights on the digital platforms, and through that would have capability to ensure effective enforcement of copyrights. Beyond that, as Thor also showed in his presentation, in terms of licensing, it's clear that the process of licensing in many creative industries doesn't really take advantage of the digitalization and the technological capabilities that we have. Then there's also the issue of authors not being recognized as such in the digital environment, etc. So we have indeed started to recognize that some kind of a decentralized corporate infrastructure would add great value to dealing with those matters. At the same time, it's clear that creating a corporate infrastructure is technologically... I'm sorry, somebody's grilling. It's clear that creating a corporate infrastructure is technologically incredibly complex. So there are many actors involved, such as artists and other right holders, digital platforms, database owners, public sector, etc. So bringing disruption into a market which already flows in a particular riverbed is a hugely complex task. And our approach today in Estonia is that we have just started experimenting with different technological and governance solutions and then test some of those solutions in the small ecosystem that is the Estonian music sector. So we can have this very agile learning process to understand how a corporate infrastructure can be created, how it can be delivered. Obviously, the end goal is not to create an Estonian own corporate infrastructure, but to bring those lessons to a wider audience. And hopefully it can serve as a useful reference point in developing something pan-European or even worldwide. So with that, I'm going to hand over now to Philipp Rikson, who leads the project that is done in Estonia, and then who is best equipped to explain what kind of approaches and experiments we are conducting. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Henrik, and good afternoon to everyone. I think we get another next slide. Thank you. So music streaming is the domain of our experiments. In this diagram, music flows red from the left to the right, from the songwriter's brains to the listener ears. And remuneration should flow green from the right to the left, from the subscriber's pockets or advertiser's budget to the artist's bank account. At each step, from the left to the right, music carries data. At each step, from the right to the left, data carries money. These data flows are complex, slow, costly, and prone to inaccuracies. We wonder if we can build a collective registry to help simplify and speed up licensing and remuneration while increasing accuracy and decreasing costs. We focus on a registry of rights management information. It would be public, public like in public transport. It would be distributed. It would need to be trusted. It could cover various creative industries and several regulations through interoperability, not through one size fitting all. We use open standards. We adopt an inclusive architecture, meaning that all stakeholders on the value network of music could interact with the registry and benefit from it. We rely on proven technologies, technologies that not only do the job, but do the job in a way which is accepted today by trade bodies and the courts. We use DISTRI, a distributed trusted rights framework. Our content-binding protocol binds immutably content-dependent identifiers of songs or recordings with identities of creators or rights holders, as close as possible to the moment of creation. At that binding, we hook rights metadata, which are securely augmented step by step when the work or its manifestations move from the left to the right. We are using the International Standard Content Code, ICC, to build a content binding protocol. This open registry fulfills a function of public interest. Creators can declare their right. These rights are attributed and attested. When queried, the registry provides rights management information. That is its remit. A registry does not license, distribute, or remunerate. A multitude of competing not-for-profit or commercial organizations will be able to rely on the registry information to license, distribute, and remunerate, if they can trust the registry, which raises important questions around its governance. Our experiments will allow us to answer two main questions. A technical question. Can we use a content-binding protocol to register and exchange the rights management information necessary to license music and remunerate creators, performers, and rights holders? And a procedural question. Can we define an authoritative governance and sustainable operating model for a copyright infrastructure and its core services in Estonia? We have launched the planning phase for a pilot that will take place in September, October, and November. We will publish two white papers in January, one about the experiments and one about the governance of the registry. We are conducting the practical experiment with the Estonian music and public sectors. We are working with music makers and the collective management organizations, with the Ministry of Culture, obviously, the Ministry of Economic Affairs and Communication, to explore the integration of the registry in the public digital infrastructure, and with ENRIC's ministry, the Ministry of Justice, which hosts in Estonia the Intellectual Property Office. We means two Estonian technology providers to start with: Digicity Networks, the developer of this tree, and Creative Passport that Carlota Denini will present in a few minutes. An open public infrastructure cannot be built in isolation or from scratch. Our experiments are closely aligned with the European directives and regulations on copyright. Our developments have been triggered by the work of the Finnish presidency at the Council in 2019. We are already anticipating the impact of the EU strategy for data, the establishment of common European data spaces, and the application of the EU IP action plan. We follow also attentively the work around the European blockchain service infrastructure. The public registry should be integrated in the Estonian digital infrastructure and using its ID system. It must also be interoperable with established international standards such as ISRC, ISWC, or ISNI to identify respectively works, recording, or individuals, and with DDEX handling data and information exchange across the music industry. Last but not least, the experiments are conducted in dialogue with the international music industry and with other creative sectors such as commercial television or press publishers, with other European member states and the United Kingdom, and first with our neighbor, Finland. Thank you very much, Anna, and the Ministry of Education and Culture for inviting us today. Thank you all for your attention.
Thank you, Philippe. Thank you, Henrik, so much for this presentation. I'm really glad that this project has taken its first steps. It's important that there is funding available and also the cooperation that is needed for such projects to take place. I also see that this is a music sector project, and of course, because of the complexity in the music sector, that is kind of most interesting, I think, for many players to try on. But of course, I understand that these are models that can be also developed and used in other creative sectors. And the Finnish copyright infrastructure is, of course, a broad or initiative that has broad approach to all different creative sectors in order to also learn from each other, because the development is different, the phase is different in different sectors. Some are much further away, and some are really in their early stages. So thank you very much, Henrik and Philippe. Thank you for the kind words as well. I'm glad that we have been able to inspire for this work. Any questions for Henrik or Philippe at the moment? I can give the floor to one or two questions at this stage, or then we can discuss later in the end. I see at the moment, I can't see any questions. These slides, both of the Thor's slides and also this presentation, as well as the rest of the materials, will be on the Dialogue portal. The link was provided to you in the invitation, so I hope that most of you can go and check for the materials there and look even closer to these topics. Thank you very much, Henrik and Philippe. So now we can move forward. I hope that we have Martin Schaefer. Are you already available to present your project that you had on the German presidency?
I'm ready. Thank you, Anna.
Thank you.
So yes, I'm a kind of strange animal in this context because I'm a lawyer. So why should I, as a lawyer, come to present something concerning metadata? The reason for that is simple. I've been working within the music industry and for the music industry for the past 30 years in an industry federation and in a record label, and now as an attorney. I have also been a decade-long member of and also chairman of the advisory board of the German National Library's music archive. And last but not least, have also been involved in the early stages of coining the requirements of the ISRC, the standard recording code for music. And in a way, this has remained to be a very, how shall I say, an issue that I was very, very strongly attached to. And I took it up to, in conjunction with others and the Ministry of Justice and Consumer Protection, to see whether this could be used as a supplement, what I'm going to propose to use, as a supplement to all what is being presented today. So it is nothing that is aimed against any of what we've heard and will hear today, but as another option to add value to all this. So if I, next slide, please. Thank you. So it starts with the music industry, and it is based on the music industry because the music industry, as we all know, is probably the most complicated area for solving metadata issues. If you can make it there, you'll make it anywhere. And I suppose that's why everyone is talking about the music industry primarily when it comes to metadata and the best use of making of metadata and the best way to make them as good as possible. So what is currently the issue is that everyone is having databases, and the databases are connected with singular other databases. Most of them are proprietary, and I can only say from my experience that nobody really wants to share the proprietary data with others unless being forced to. Next slide, please. My experience has shown that centralized databases, if you take them as a stable, monumental, big solution, are likely to fail. There have been attempts to create those central databases, and if they are not supplemented by something to keep them alive, from the very moment on they are created, they are likely to die a relatively swift death by lack of update. I look forward to Jason's presentation later to learn, because I shouldn't have written finally. I should have phrased it as a question, because I'm interested to learn how in the US you will be dealing with the with this issue in the Music Modernization Act. Next slide, please. Music shows especially well where the problem lies, because metadata, if it comes bad, and in the music industry it always comes bad, that you have everything that can make such matter complicated put on each other. So first of all, there are different types of content, even in the administration of music, but also, of course, if other elements like audiovisual productions come into play, something as simple as a music video. So you have loads of different sets of data you need for each type of content. Then you have a multi-layered situation concerning the rights holders. There are many rights holders with different sets of rights. Then you have an international situation where rarely ever one entity owns the rights on a worldwide basis. In fact, certain sets of rights are often split into many national licenses, and not necessarily all rights holders do split them in the same way. Then it's highly volatile, because rights are a tradable asset. So ownership in rights changes frequently. Let's assume a music publishing company is growing. They will acquire catalogs. The catalogs are coming into new ownership. Others stay where they are, because often, and that's the last thing, these rights are highly fragmented. It's never as easy as you have a composition and a composer and a lyricist. In fact, you have many co-composers usually, and you have many co-lyricists, and they are not always with the same publisher. So if publisher A sells his catalog to someone else, the others remain where they are, but the situation is totally changed. The former situation. So within a short period of time, you will get into a situation where you need to update your information. And this is, believe me, one of the principal problems everywhere, because those who acquire catalogs are likely to notify the CMOs as quickly as they can, but the previous owner isn't. So you have double entries for the same work or performance. Next slide, please. Thank you. As I said earlier, we have the problem that nobody wants to share information on the basis of letting others access one's own database. So the idea would be create a neutral instance that is creating a database of itself, but is used as a search engine and buffers the various participants in the system against misuse, and thus allows everyone to participate by the means of the search engine, enhance one's own data quality by a clever algorithm that is designed to see, for instance, if the entry for the rights ownership of publisher A is older than the entry of publisher B, who has acquired the rights, it's likely that publisher B's rights are the more accurate. Next slide, please. This was the basis for a study commissioned by the German Ministry of Justice and Consumer Protection with Professor Gronau and his team, I was one of those who set it up together with him, just to explore the possibilities of something like it. And this study was presented during the German Council Presidency in the virtual copyright conference last fall. You can get the presentation materials at the link I indicated. Next slide, please. The key findings in this study are important, I think, for the further if there is any future of this idea, because it requires certain conditions that need to be met to make it work. First, a search engine like this needs to be neutral. It should not be used to level the commercial grounds on which all the players act. If any of the players, let it be a CMO or a large music publisher or whatever else business that is tempted to connect itself to the system, has to fear that it will undermine their market position, they will simply not join. And this is all based on the idea that everyone benefits. Then you have the decentralized structure as the core of it all. So the scope of this whole thing is to enhance the individual database and not to create a central one. Then one of the issues that is utterly important, this is nothing you can kind of buy by money. The currency of the system is metadata. And so only if people contribute by opening their systems to others are they able to get access to the others. Then well, we need to find ways, this is something that needs to be explored in more depth, to keep the system from being drained into central databases and simply used to create something that is then only used for singular updates, but marketed outside the system. And then we will always need in the center to make it trustworthy, an open, transparent, and non-commercial setup for the algorithm as such. Next slide, please. Yeah, that was all I see. So I shall be happy to take questions. And I do firmly believe that that this is all something that could be accompanying each of these other projects, because from all I've heard, everyone might at least to a certain degree rely on those kinds of metadata enhancement and quality. For instance, if you have not registered at an early stage and need to find a content to get it in line with your system requirements, like we have seen in the past in the last presentation. So thank you very much, and I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you very much, Martin, for your presentation. I see there's already one request for the floor. So please, Matthias Schmidt, you have the floor. Nice to see you, hopefully, if you will open your camera. Matthias, okay. Yes, you have the floor.
Hello, sorry. Hello, Anna. Sorry for that. It was only a mistake. I don't want to raise the hands. I'm trying to get a little bit more with my smartphone here, and I'm still trying. Sorry for that.
Well, it doesn't matter. I have to say that because you were really one of those initiators for this project, right? With Martin. I mean, I remember during the Finnish presidency, you mentioned something about the metadata enhancement machine. So this is really what it was, and it's really good that the German presidency after the Croatian presidency both have kept the corporate infrastructure topic, very topical, and we continue from there. So thank you very much for that, Matthias. Any other questions at this stage? We have some 10 minutes actually before Carlotta. So the floor is open for these three presentations relating to the music industry and different kind of angles they all have. And okay, I see Timo Oiva. You have the floor, Timo.
Thank you, Anna. Hi everyone. This is Timo Oiva. I'm a master's student. I'm doing thesis for the ministry now in relation to future orientation of Finnish copyright stakeholders. And I just want to point out that all of the previous presentations had something in common that I want to comment, these projects are very similar and are kind of spearheading the development that's connected to European common data spaces. So I just want to point out to all copyright infrastructure people that the work that you are doing is transferable, in my perspective, to European Common Data Spaces initiatives and the big data business. For example, now we were in Dr. Martin Schaefer's concept or the presentation on the decentralized place. I think one element for this could be also the to have a metadata stock exchange where you could monetize metadata and then you could, you know, transfer metadata as an asset, and you could all you could there could be tons of financial solutions, even, you know, leverage metadata, buy futures of metadata. So you could have a stock exchange for monetizing all kind of metadata. So that's one commercial perspective. And I think that the transfer of metadata and knowledge and secure data is relevant to infrastructure industry, mobility database, it's health data. So all the solutions that we're building here are the solutions that everybody in Europe are talking about in relation to European common data spaces. So I just want to point out this, that this is not sector specific, but this is hugely horizontal for the European development. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Timo, for these views. I mean, they go aligned to what Finland has been in our approach saying, is that the data strategy and the data economy is a framework where the copyright and creative sectors also should be working really swiftly in. But what Timo is saying also is, I think, that we could be not only finding solutions for the creative sectors, but also for other sectors. So be very, very much helpful there in with the technologies that we already have and with the practices we have on intellectual property, which is like an asset that is intellectual. It's like data, but it's, of course, has its own features of creativity also. Thank you for that point of view. And then I have two other speakers. I think David was first and then followed by Thor. So please, David, you have the floor.
Thank you. Just a general question, really, to all kind of the presentations so far. What is the kind of reaction from industry stakeholders? Because, you know, it's great having all these potential solutions, but if the industry stakeholders don't buy them, then it's going to be a struggle in implementing anything. I mean, it's one of the issues that we've always struggled with in the UK is getting the industry to come together and take action and develop kind of solutions that will be cross. I mean, for the music industry, it's not just one industry. There's many, many industries within the music industry. And how do you bring those all together?
Thank you very much, David. Who wants to start? Maybe Thor, because you already raised your hand, so you can start, and then maybe we could have responses from all from Philip as well and Martin also. So please, Thor first.
Unmute first. First, I just a comment to Timo, which was my original, why I raised. There is already a very large community that are trading in metadata. We are not handling the metadata, we're handling registration and licensing, but it's open protocol based in Berlin. So he can check that out. They are really, really doing some fantastic work. As the second question, yes, we are talking to, or have been for a very, very long time. And we are talking primarily to the 250-300 copyright or creators that are representing 95% of the streaming income in the world. So we are not at this stage talking on a very broad basis. We are starting and doing this top down. So, if there are anybody interested, take contact with me and we can tell you more.
Thank you, Thor. And then Philippe, please.
I wanted to say just basically that we do experiment and we do experiment with the music industry. We are not coming to the music industry telling them we have a new solution for you, all your problem. So that is a question of point of view, if you want. The music industry exists, copyright exists in the music industry for more than 100 years. So whatever will be done by whoever, it will be a migration, permanent migration to other systems. So that is one thing. The other thing is that we are dealing only with the registry. The registry has to be open and inclusive. Inclusive means that anybody should benefit from the registry. And anybody, meaning all CMOs, Joe, the guitarist next door, Google, Spotify, whoever. So this inclusive approach makes us approachable by the music industry, and our modest point of view to start with, so that we do experiment, makes that many people in the music industry are speaking with us. So that's my main answer to David, my friend David. And we will, of course, continue to work together, and but not as people who know better, which is surely not our position, but modestly trying to find solution together. And it seems promising for the moment.
Thank you. And then Martin, please.
Yes, thank you. I have a short response to Timo as well, because yes, I think what you said is absolutely right. All the three presentations have shown in the same direction, and as we have now seen from the responses to the questions, they all emphasize this thorough openness. And indeed, if you look into the presentation that was delivered to during the governmental conference in Germany last year, you will see that one of the factors for making the system of this metadata search engine work is putting a value to each metadata bit of information. So there will be some kind of a coin that is the currency for this exchange. So the idea of assigning a value to a set of metadata is indeed something that is crucial for the whole thing, and can in the long term lead to a metadata economy as a self-supported thing that can also help to get this whole thing up and running. Second, and that's to David's question, I think this has been partially answered by Philippe already. Those things are all based on the idea of being not proprietary. So the large corporations that are dealing, especially in the music sector, but elsewhere in the content industries, are of course hesitant to give it a try before it's ready, because they love things they own. And all the systems that have been presented today are designed to not be owned by a large company, but be free and open to be used by everyone, small and big. And I think eventually, it's like with standards and several other issues that need to be common, that the positive effect that can be coming from this for the entire industry will be so convincing that all those who have so far only contributed by delivering information, because in the study, of course, the big labels contributed, but they will eventually join once it's there, but not before.
Thank you very much, Martin. I will allow for one comment still from Hua Jung Sun, but then we have to move forward with the program. So please, Hua Jung, you have the floor. Microphone, please. Can't hear you, sorry. Okay.
Oh, can you hear me now?
Yes, now, yes.
Now we're right, okay. Yes. So just about the comment on the Central European Central Database, I think this research really, you know, any research in this field should really look at what happened with GRD. There was already an historical attempt to build a central database, and we really have to think about why that has not happened when there is a clear incentive. And it's going to solve so many problems. Why do we not have a central database? I think maybe one of the central issues that we have to ask. And according to the research findings that we got from the Music 2025 was the conflict of interest. Although I do welcome all these great developments, but I am at the same time not entirely convinced, just because all the rest of non-proprietary databases will be collected, these big corporations who make a lot of money, or at least are incentivized not to join, will actually join. I think, how do we make them, how do we find a way to incentivize them to work together? I think it's one thing that we have to think about. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Huajung, for your comment. And it's really true that what also Martin said about the non-proprietariness is could be something to that we still need to discuss within the industries. I mean, of course, the Finnish approach is all the time to work with the industry. So anything that, you know, is there, you know, stumbling block, let's say, on developing further, we need to address it. So these are really good points that was were raised. But now I think we can go forward to the next speaker, who is David Humphreys. And so please, you have the floor, and you have the project on music creators education. I will leave the possibility for commenting later in the after the presentation. So Thor, please wait for that.
Great. Here we go. So just by way of introduction, I'm David Humphreys. I'm head of research at the UK Intellectual Property Office. We're the rights granting body in the UK for all of the IP rights. And we also manage the policy perspective. So working across government to ensure that IP has impact and is taken into account of across all of the government policy agenda. My role is managing the research programme as a whole for the Intellectual Property Office. We are committed to evidence-based policymaking, and we commission, or I commission, around kind of 8 to 10 independent research projects to inform the development of policy. Next slide, please. Next slide. Here we go. So one of the research projects that that I commissioned was Music 2025, which was published in June 2019. I brought together a team of independent academics. Dr. Hyojung Sun was the principal researcher there, and she stole some of my thunder with some of her comments. One of the key aims of Music 2025 was to really to better understand what the issues were facing the music industry and to highlight some potential solutions of how the UK music industry could be sustainable and successful going forward. So following over 50 semi-structured interviews, many of whom across the music industry, many of whom have never been spoken to before. So it was a really inclusive project, and we really made a big effort to draw in people that hadn't necessarily been spoken to give them a voice. And it was very much appreciated. And yeah, again, for the music industry, which is a fractured industry, we gained some really, really positive feedback across the board from all parts of the industry, which was really positive. So the key areas of focus were education, raising the importance of data across the music industry, but also about it was educating from the creator base right up to the top levels of industry. So making sure that everybody was aware of the importance of getting data right. Interoperability. So again, this has been spoken about quite a lot. There are lots and lots of data systems. There are lots and lots of databases. There are lots of standards. You know, there's the ISRC, ISWC, ISNI, IPIs. There's so much. And so how can we produce, or how can we get industry to work together to increase interoperability? there is DDEX. DDEX is doing a fantastic job. There are great initiatives there that the industry are working on, but more can be done. And again, how do you make that happen? You make that happen through governance. So how do we bring all of the industry together to promote a harmonization of processes and set those infrastructure standards? And again, highlighting how many people had never been spoken to before through our interviews. How do we better collaborate? How do we bring people together in more informal processes as well to ensure that we engage with the whole of the creative value chain? Next slide, please. So kind of actions that came from Music 2025, we established two working groups, one on data standards and one on education and awareness. Sadly, as the work was progressing, there was real buy-in to this, there was real enthusiasm to do something. COVID hit, and sadly the working groups have kind of fallen by the wayside. Somewhat. We're beginning to reinvigorate that work. And one of the areas that we can take forward and we are taking forward is around educating and raising awareness of the importance of both of data and how and where you register your rights to ensure that you get remuneration, but also the right attribution. And so one of the projects that has recently been published is Music Copyright Explained, which is basically a copyright 101. It's an idiot's guide really for everybody within the music industry to show, give them a signposting as to where and how they register their rights. It's gone down amazingly well with the industry. It was signed off by all parts of the music industry and we're getting, it's getting huge traction across the music industry. So I'm really, really pleased with that. The link is there, please share it. We're quite happy for people to copy and use the data that we have from that. Next slide, please. So what next in terms of work in this space? So on top of, again, flowing really from Music 2025, that was a real catalyst for action across the board, both politically within government and also within industry. One of the things that has happened since then is the DCMS, Department for Culture, or the Digital Culture, Media and Sport Select Committee within Parliament has established an inquiry into the economics of streaming. And this covered, again, a significant amount of ground around issues of data and transparency. And that report is due to be issued in May. And the government will have to respond to that in full. So that is coming very shortly. Again, another project that we have commissioned and which Dr. Sun is leading on is around creators' earnings. And this looks into what has the impact been of streaming on the creator and their remuneration. And hopefully the research will be delivered to the IPO in June. And we'll be holding hopefully some peer review events to really kind of expose the findings of that to our audience. And then building on the Music Copyright Explained, one of the key issues is data, is, how and where and how can we better improve an awareness of metadata. So I'm going to be commissioning, hopefully in the next few months, a Data 101. Again, hoping to work with a cross-industry team. I'm already in discussion with UK Music, which is the kind of umbrella body for the UK music industry, about how we can deliver that piece of work. One of the first things will be to do an audit of what education and awareness initiatives there are already there. And again, we have to be mindful that, again, data is not bound by borders. So being part of these discussions, being part of this workshop and having those connections is going to be ever more important in what is a kind of a global landscape. So that's me.
Thank you so much. Yes, thank you, David. And we'll go immediately to Carlotta Denini, please, so you can continue.
Okay, thank you very much. And my name is Carlotta Denini, and I'm the CEO of the Creative Passport. I might just need to wait for the slides to appear so that I can go on.
There, yes.
Here
there.
We go.
Yep.
Amazing. So I'm quite excited to be here as part of this workshop and also kind of the ongoing work with Finland in general, because the Creative Passport was actually started by British artist Imogen Heap, but the actual development of the product was kick-started some years ago thanks to a Finnish organization named Citra, because we were one of the chosen use cases as part of the IAN project to investigate the use of self-sovereign identity in the creative industry, and specifically in this case, in the music industry. And next slide. But then, what is the Creative Passport? So the Creative Passport is a verified digital identity for music makers that would help them to access, update, and manage information about themselves and their works, and share it with integrated third-party services or infrastructures. So in this case, we can kind of imagine in the Creative Passport being a way for music makers and creators, and potentially also other creators as part of the creative industries, to be part and interact and input information in a copyright infrastructures. The thing is that, as also David was saying before me, there is a very big need with what regards education about around the importance of data, the importance of identifiers. And so, next slide, please. We kind of realized that we need to explain to music makers in this case, why do they need a tool like the Creative Passport? And the reality is that once they kind of understand that the fact that they really spend lots of time on music admin, in this case, specifically, whether it's updating biography around or making sure to update all information about themselves in different services, as well as the importance of being represented and being paid for a song that they either created or performed. And everything kind of links back to their identity and the identifiers. And sometimes music makers, unfortunately, struggle a little bit to try to understand the importance of having this data in one place and ready to be shared with the industry. Obviously, another major point is how music makers can be found and offered new work and collaboration. And then with the can be found kind of concept, clearly is also a matter of being able to control and be the authoritative source of information about themselves, not only for collaboration and artist-to-artist collaboration, but potentially also for the industry in itself. And the kind of aim for the Creative Passport is to make it easy for music makers to provide this information as part to the industry. And besides being kind of ensuring that music makers are in control and privacy by design is respected, and also on top of the education around identifiers and the awareness around the importance of information, a very fundamental thing is the whole discussion around interoperability. Because obviously we're discussing around efficiency and costs, not only for the industry per se, so to have, you know, like improved information, therefore improved efficiency and decreasing costs, but then is also an efficiency in the music maker side of things, because obviously if better information and authoritative information are needed by the human beings and by the music makers, again, how can we make it easier for them to provide this information? How can we improve the collaborative experience that music makers have with different industry players, whether is their representatives from labels, publishers, and collection societies, whether is with third-party services from streaming services or credit capturing softwares, or in this case, with a bigger infrastructure, such a what it could be, a copyright infrastructure. And next slide, please. Obviously, we're speaking about personal information, right? So currently, the kind of information that we are helping music makers to link together are profile information such as artistic name or different artistic name, biographies, skills, roles, interest, inspiration, instruments played. So quite information that are related to their profile as artists. Then we've got IDs and identifiers, which is verification and real and government verified name, industry identifiers, ISNI, IPI, and IPN. And then again, I cannot stress the fact that it really, based on the kind of experience and our users, the concept of identifier and knowing what an IPI, an IPN is, it really needs to be pushed, because unfortunately, music makers do not have the kind of knowledge, and sometimes the industry kind of gives a little bit for granted that these kind of information are understood as well as are just known as from the music makers community. Then we've got also other pieces of information what regards representatives and contacts, so who to contact in the past or in the present for that specific person, and then as well other information like official links and other information could be live performances, credits, brands who the music makers they collaborated with. Clearly, we do think that the creative passport can be one of the puzzle pieces, right? Allowing music makers to become the authoritative source of personal information from the industry, and specifically, the kind of integrations that we are trying to achieve are not only with current industry players, but then we are also experimenting and going a little bit further also with the technologies used, such as the collaboration and being part of the experiment with the DISTRI project. So in that case, what the creative passport role in that experiment of the copyright infrastructure would be, how can we make it easy for music makers to authenticate themselves, to provide industry identifier and potentially kind of their real name to the infrastructure and all information about themselves that can be linked to the song registration, so that wherever the song registration and the recording will end up, so do they, so that there is a clear information on who needs to be paid in this case. And also kind of to close, if you like, the presentation is that right now we have been using technologies that are quite, you know, it's kind of more accepted by the industry. And as I said before, as part of the EON project, we have been experimenting the use of self-sovereign identity. So obviously, as part of our technological development, and hopefully also with the experimentation and development that we're going to be having with DISTRI, we are really trying to have the creative passport becoming a digital identity, a self-sovereign identity for music makers, allowing them to share verified credentials in order to prove who they are, and then kind of integration with third-party services and other infrastructures that are ready to receive credentials and verified credentials. Thank you very much.
thank you very much, Carlotta, for this this presentation. This is something we have been familiar with because of Citra, for instance, being able to finance this. Citra is a innovation fund in Finland, and they are really involved in the data economy and trying to provide services for companies, for instance, to enable data sharing and really find the value from sharing data in a positive way with the shared benefits. So let's go forward directly to Jason Sloan. So we will leave then in the end some time for discussion. So please, we have Jason Sloan from the US Copyright Office talking about metadata and the Music Modernization Act.
Hi, everyone. Thanks. I'm Jason Sloan. I'm Assistant General Counsel with the United States Copyright Office. Thank you so much for having me. Happy to be here to talk about metadata and the Music Modernization Act, or MMA. First, for those of you who may not be familiar with the U.S. Copyright Office, we're the federal agency in the United States responsible for administering the Copyright Act and related laws. We register copyrighted works, record documents pertaining to copyrights, administer the various statutory licenses under U.S. law. We issue regulations through rulemaking, engage in policy studies, advise Congress, assist other federal agencies, as well as the courts, and are also involved on the international stage. So since we were asked to only have a couple slides, rather than try to cram everything in there, what I have here is really some links to more information about the MMA. If you go to the next slide, please. This is our MMA homepage on our website, and this links out to all of our other MMA-related pages. And then the next slide after this, if you go to that one, please. These are some direct links to some of the pages that are most relevant to the discussion today. Some of these are various regulations we've adopted that deal with the reporting and sharing of metadata. There's a link to a general education page about the MMA and also a link to a webpage about our unclaimed royalty study, where we're going to have a report coming out in July, which I'll talk more about in a little bit. And then at the bottom there, that's a link to the MLC's homepage, the Mechanical Licensing Collective, and I'll talk more about what that is in a minute as well. So just some background, Music Modernization Act. This was probably the most significant change in U.S. copyright law in 20 years. It was passed unanimously in October of 2018 and did a number of things, but the one we're most focused on today here is mechanical licensing. So the way things work in the U.S. is when music stream, that implicates two distinct works of authorship, the musical composition and the sound recording capturing a particular performance of that composition. In the U.S., mechanical licensing of musical works, meaning the reproduction and distribution of the musical work in the form of phonorecords, is subject to compulsory licensing, which means the licensee can use an eligible work without having to get the copyright owner's permission, as long as they comply with the statutory requirements, including serving various notices and statements and paying royalties that are set at a rate by the government. Quick fun fact, in the US, the compulsory license actually dates back to 1909, and it came about out of these fears over that a monopoly might happen on piano player roles. But prior to the MMA, the compulsory mechanical license operated on a song-by-song basis. Users had to send notices and royalties and accounting statements to each relevant copyright owner for each individual musical work they wanted to use. And if the copyright owner wasn't identified in the office's records, notice had to be filed with the office. And if that happened, the user didn't have to pay any royalties for the license unless and until the owner became identified in the office's records. The fact that the compulsory license operated on a song-by-song basis made it difficult for the large streaming services that began to emerge in the last decade or so to use it and for copyright owners to get paid their royalties. You know, the digital services have catalogs of upwards of 60 million tracks, and they need to be able to match up those sound recordings with the musical work copyright owners so they know who to pay mechanical royalties to. And the problem was trying to figure all that out. There was no authoritative database with all that information. So when the services couldn't find a copyright owner, or they weren't sure that they had matched everything up correctly, they generally filed a notice with the office to kind of cover themselves. And that resulted in the office getting thousands of notices covering over 90 million titles over the course of just a couple of years. There's also some high profile litigation going on at the time with a few different class action lawsuits against certain services for allegedly failing to serve notices and pay royalties. So with these challenges going on, no one was really happy with the compulsory license. Many in the music marketplace were kind of lamenting the outdated and inefficient song by song system and the fact that authoritative data was lacking. And they believed licensing could be significantly improved if the data could be improved. So the industry came together and worked collaboratively and compromised with each other on a negotiated piece of legislation. And that is what resulted in the Music Modernization Act. So one thing to keep in mind here before I go on is I'm only talking about mechanical licensing of musical works. So I'm not talking about licensing the musical works performance rights or the licensing of the sound recording. Those are handled separately and differently from the compulsory license. So what the MMA did was it replaced the old song-by-song system with a new blanket licensing system for digital music providers, or DMPs, that covers all musical works that are available for compulsory licensing. The blanket license first became available at the beginning of 2021, and direct voluntary licensing is still allowed. The old song-by-song system was kept in place, though, for non-digital uses like CDs and vinyl. The MMA also created a new entity called the Mechanical Licensing Collective, or MLC, and it's a centralized administrator for the new blanket license. It acts as a single source where all DMPs send their reporting and payments, and from where all copyright owners receive their royalties and accounting statements, rather than what was happening before, where each DMP had to deal with each owner and vice versa, and they had to keep track of all of that. So now the MLC will do it all centrally, which is meant to help with transparency and efficiency. The MLC is not part of the Copyright Office, but the entity acting as the MLC is designated by the office. We had a whole process for that shortly after the MMA was passed. The MLC is subject to our oversight and regulation, and under the statute, there's a public review of the MLC's designation every 5 years. The MMA also centralizes the matching process through which the sound recordings used by the DMPs have to be identified and linked to their underlying musical works. And then the owners of the musical works are identified and located so they can be paid. Previously, each DMP was doing that on its own or hiring a vendor to do it for them. But now the MLC will do it for all of the DMPs using the blanket license. One of the important changes that was made by the MMA is that the statute requires the MLC to hold royalties associated with unmatched musical works or unmatched shares of a work for at least 3 years and to continue to try to match the usage during that time. The MLC is also required to create and maintain a publicly available online list of unmatched musical works and shares through which ownership claims can be made. So during the holding period, copyright owners can examine the unmatched usage data reported by the DMPs and make claims, and simultaneously, the MLC will be engaging in its own matching efforts. I'll just add that the MLC's claiming portal has not yet been launched. My understanding, they've said that they plan to do that in June. Getting into metadata more specifically, the MMA made a number of important changes in addition to the claiming portal. I'm going to talk about two in particular. And that's DMP reporting and creation of a musical works database. Regarding DMP reporting, obviously reporting is nothing new, but the statute now lists out a variety of specific types of metadata that DMPs are required to report to the MLC about its usage. The office concluded a rulemaking on the subject of DMP reporting in the fall, which carries out the statutory requirements and also added several other data fields and related requirements based on public comments, which altogether should result in DMPs reporting more data about their usage than ever before, which should help the MLC in its matching efforts and hopefully lead to less unclaimed royalties. Important thing to understand about the data that DMPs have available to report about their usage is that commenters told us that in most cases, it comes from the record label or distributor of the sound recording. The DMP generally gets a DDEX feed from the labels and distributors, and that's what flows through into their systems and eventually gets reported out. In terms of the actual data requirements, the The statute organizes them into tiers, and I'll just kind of rattle these off to get, so you can get a sense of what's required. The first is about the sound recording, and these are always required, and that's sound recording titles, featured artists, DMP assigned unique identifiers, including ones that can be used to locate and listen to the sound recording, and the actual playing time. The second tier is also about the sound recording, but these are required to the extent information is actually acquired by the DMP, and that's sound recording copyright owners, producers, ISRCs, any other unique identifiers associated with the sound recording, including an associated album, like a catalog number, UPC, or a distributor assigned unique identifier. Then there's also versions, release dates, album titles, label names, distributors, and other information commonly used in the industry to identify sound recordings and match them to their musical works. The third tier is about the musical work, and these are required to the extent it's acquired by the DMP in the metadata provided to the DMP by the labels or distributors. And that's songwriters, publishers, musical work copyright owners, ISNIs, and IPIs for each of those, ownership shares, ISWCs, and musical work titles. And I'll just note that some of these are subject to transition periods that expire in September. And if a DMP is missing any of that data, the statute and our regulations require that they engage in good faith, commercially reasonable efforts to try to obtain it from the label or distributor. Moving on to the database. So unlike the claiming portal, the database is currently live on the MLC's website, though I think it's in a beta at the moment, but it's on the website. The statute requires the MLC to create a free public online database of musical works and their owners, and also their associated sound recordings, to help address the longstanding problem of identifying the right copyright owner to pay when it comes to mechanical licensing in the US. So it's not really meant to be a global everything to everyone database that magically fixes all of the industry's problems. It's about US mechanical rights. Though obviously it's going to contain information that'll be helpful in other contexts. But for example, though nothing prohibits it, at the moment it's not going to have PRO information about performance rights licensing. And I do just want to make clear, even though it's about US mechanical rights, but it's not just limited to US works. It covers non-US works as well. Obviously, those can earn royalties from usage in the US, and that'll go through the MLC just like domestic works. So like with the usage reporting, the MMA spells out a lot of the requirements for the database, and the Copyright Office had a rulemaking to establish regulations to carry out the requirements and also added several other data fields and related requirements based on public comments. In terms of access to the database, it has to be made available online for free to the general public. It has to be searchable, and it has to be kept updated in real time. The MLC also has to make it available in a bulk real-time machine-readable format to the public. It can charge a fee for that, though, but the fee can't exceed the marginal cost to the MLC to actually provide the data. The MLC also has to implement bulk access to the data through APIs by the end of 2021. I'll just note that some entities are entitled to bulk access free of charge, and it's mainly the DMPs that are operating under the blanket license and their vendors, and then also the Copyright Office. As far as the information that has to be included in the database, it differs depending on whether it's a matched musical work or an unmatched musical work. But the statute and regulations set out a minimum floor, so nothing prohibits the MLC from including additional non-confidential information. So like with the reporting requirements, I'll just rattle these off. The statute organizes them into tiers. For matched works, the minimum data fields that are always required are musical work titles, musical work copyright owners, ownership shares, contact information for the musical work copyright owners, and the MLC assigned unique identifier for the work. Then there are data fields that are required to the extent information is reasonably available to the MLC. And that's alternative musical work titles, ISWCs, songwriters, administrators, ISNIs, and IPIs for each musical work copyright owner, songwriter, and administrator, DMP assigned unique identifiers, and opus and catalog numbers for classical compositions. And then also for each sound recording in which the musical work is embodied, there's ISRCs, sound recording titles, sound recording copyright owners, featured artists, playing time, versions, release dates, producers, UPCs, and any other non-confidential information the MLC reasonably believes would be helpful in linking sound recordings to musical works. For unmatched works, the requirements are similar, except all of it is to the extent reasonably available to the MLC. In terms of how the database is populated, the MLC has said that for musical work information, it will source it from musical work copyright owners or their administrators. So owners need to register with the MLC and provide their data directly. They have to register anyway to provide necessary location and payment information so the MLC can distribute their royalties to them. One thing in particular that's been noted about the database by industry stakeholders is that what really helps is that it creates a central place where owners and writers can provide their data, check it and correct it to make sure it's current and accurate. And I just want to be clear that, you know, as I've mentioned, registering with the MLC is only for US mechanical rights. So copyright owners would still need to register with PROs like ASCAP and BMI for performance rights, and they would still need to register with us, with the Copyright Office, to get the statutory benefits of US registration, like being able to enforce your rights in court and eligibility for certain enhanced damages. As for the sound recording data, the MLC has said it intends to primarily use the data provided by DMPs in their usage reporting to populate the database. Additionally, under the statute and our regulations, musical work copyright owners are required to engage in commercially reasonable efforts to deliver certain information about sound recordings, embodying their compositions to the MLC for the database to the extent they know it and it's practicable. And in response to public comments for the sound recording information, the office's regulations require the MLC to identify the source of the information and to display a disclaimer to clarify that the database is not authoritative as to sound recording information. The database not only has to be updated in real time, but historical data has to be retained as well to allow tracking of changes over time. And one last really important point about the database is that under our regulations, in response to public comments, the data is considered public data and is not owned by the MLC or any of its employees, agents, consultants, vendors, contractors, anything like that. The very last thing I want to note is right now the office is in the middle of a study about best practices for the MLC to consider implementing to help reduce the incidence of unclaimed royalties. We're looking at things like the kind of education and outreach the MLC should engage in, its data and matching practices, issues relating to copyright owners and songwriters signing up, registering, claiming, and using the database, policies surrounding the holding and distribution of unclaimed royalties, and how to measure success. And our report will be issued in July. So that's it. I know that was a lot really fast, but I'm happy to answer any questions. And thank you so much for having me.
Thank you very much, Jason. Yes, it was a lot in a short time, but I'm really glad that you did that because it really kind of very nicely gives this sort of bigger picture, you know, that we have from a European point of view, our view is different from the US, of course, and then we have UK now in a new position as well. So, you know, this was needed information, and I hope that we will be able to look into further, you know, the links that you provided, and really look forward to the. Maybe use some of your experiences, you know, regarding best practices in general. Of course, I mean, the systems are different and they don't cover the same things, but still it's not really about that, you know, it's more like on a general approach, trying to see what links to what and what would be beneficial. So thank you very much for your presentation. Now we have 15 minutes for discussion, and I will first note this one comment that was made by Lucy Janechkova in the chat box. Maybe if you, Lucy, you are still online, maybe you would like to ask your question from the speakers, because I'm not really sure to which speaker you had presented your question. I can read it out. Or are you online? Maybe you can do it.
Yes, I am online. Do you hear me?
Yes, please.
Okay. Thank you very much for the time. The question was addressed to the first speaker, to Mr. Tor Peterson.
Okay, great. Great. So then, Tor, you have the floor and you can continue from here. Mike, please.
Yes, I saw it, Lucy, and I assumed it was to me. We already have a team in place in Hungary, and you have to excuse me. I cannot remember the last name, but it's Peter, who is you probably know him from work in the PROs in Hungary. I'd be happy to put you in contact with him and the rest of the team who is handling East Europe.
Thank you. That would be great.
Anna has my contact details.
Okay. Thank you.
I can work as a connector again in this.
I can put it up. Yeah. Anyway. I also have a question, and actually after David and Jason, the last speaker, it's filling the same kind of questions. I hope I'm pronouncing it correctly. Hyung, she asked how to incentivize, and I have a very, very simple solution. Regulate the registration. That is, do exactly for copyright registration as you do for company regulation and shares, and set up a NASDAQ, if you like, for trading in copyright shares. Exactly as Sweden already have a public in Sweden's Riksdagen, parliament, I'd be happy to give you the link for that. It's basically under governmental, and here it comes with governance, David, and also same problem or challenges in remuneration. If you regulate the registration and trade of copyrights, it's by law, not something that are in 2000 different silos of metadata. It has to be collected and it has to be sorted, so to speak. And it's regulated publicly. We have a proposal for the Swedish government and has had since 2018, and we have had extensive discussion with a very special government, but the Isle of Man, we have had the discussion with to regulate registration on Isle of Man, because they have a very short and very public politicians force there, so it's easy to talk to them quite quickly. Unfortunately, we had something called the pandemic or COVID came in the middle of everything there. But in 2019, we had some extensive talks with the governance of Isle of Man. And I believe firmly that a regulated registration will solve a lot of the problem, because then it will be by law.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Thor. That was very clear. It was loud and clear. And I think I will give the floor now to the next speaker. I assume that Lucy Janechkova, your hand, you have raised your hand, but it's an old hand, or do you want the floor again? It's probably an old hand. So
old hand. And okay. I would like to thank you, Ms. Anna, for organizing this. Wonderful.
Okay. Thank you so much. I see Benoit Müller has requested for the floor. So please, Benoit, you have the floor.
Thank you, Anna. This is just in response to Thor's comments. I feel compelled to recall the non-formality requirement of the Bern Convention and of WIPO copyright treaties. So you may certainly regulate to some extent registration. You know, the US is a good example, but it has to be voluntary in order to be consistent with international copyright treaties.
Thank you, Benoit. This is a very important point because we are still, I mean, the reason why copyright probably has not been registered so far in a mandatory way is because of the Bern requirements. But on the other hand, there are different points of views and how you interpret it. And we had the last workshop talking about this voluntary registration possibility, and it seems like it's something that would then anyway be decentralized somehow. So, or maybe you want to continue, Tor, on your point.
Just one comment. Yes, I agree. but you have to start somewhere. And that's what I'm talking about. It won't be sold over the next, perhaps not even over the next decade. But that's why we are starting with all the independent copyright owners. And make no mistake, where I'm coming from is the creators, the composers and the writers. That's my basis, and that's where I'm coming from. And by starting there, as I said, as a comment, by starting with the 250, 300 most prominent creators who represent, let's face it, let's be honest here, who represent 95% of the income. We are talking about remuneration as well. And that's a very, very good place to start to get something done. And by that, I'm going to leave. Not leave, but so.
Thank you. It's
money always talk.
Mm-mm. Thank you, Tor, for this. Any other comments? We can now, I mean, share freely about the different presentations and questions that arise or comment in general. The floor is open. I have no comments at the moment. I can then perhaps share a few notions myself. So what I would like to raise is that we are talking about, I love the idea that EU Action Plan actually presents what the copyright infrastructure is, because we have now discussed these different projects and or use cases, and they all highlight these important elements of the infrastructure, but they're not saying, you know, and in its entirety what the copyright infrastructure would mean. And I'm not sure if this is complete, but it's in the EU Action Plan mentioned, and it says that the copyright infrastructure is a combination of rules, technologies, and institutions, and that then would frame the creative sector's data management strategy or framework. And then coming from that perspective, then the speakers that have now been speaking, basically, I think the rules would be then either, well, they can be legislative or regulated rules. There are some rules already about rights management information. And so far, probably we've been relying on them I refer to the rights management information that is protected against removal and alteration already since 20 years back. But then there are other regulations and rules that impact also the access to rights, access to data, for instance. The technologies are there, and there are different technologies. For instance, blockchain technology is used in the IP offices for trademarks and other registrations a lot. And in one of the first workshops that we organized, you can see it behind me, actually, the first December, talks about blockchain and AI tools of IP offices. The EU IP office has a very good program, I think, for 4 years ahead, where they are building blockchain-based registers, and they're able to transform the whole system into blockchain. And I think that's something that we are not able to do in the copyright field, you know, in this way, because of the databases being proprietary on the other hand, but then also the lack of this cooperation on a horizontal level that we need, and also the involvement of public and private partners, so the PPPs. I see the hand is raised, so please, Timo Oiva, you have the floor.
Hi. Is my camera on? I think it's on. Yeah, I just want to point out one thing that's just noted here, that this is a kind of an interesting level on a European level as well, because there's two commissaries in European Union, and one of them is Maria Gabriel, and she's on the creatives, industries, and culture. And then Margrethe Vestager, she's on the digital. So I think these copyright infrastructures bridging between those two. And that's an interesting part. So that's a problem as well, because then no commissioner is actually responsible of this, because this is in between. So that's a maybe a European level thing as well. So just wanted to point out that.
Yeah, thank you, Timo. It is really requiring this cooperation is to cover also the creative sectors as the sectors themselves, non-related to copyright. And normally these sectors are not easily speaking and not even noticing that the different data-related projects could have combinations with each other. For instance, the data strategy and the media action plan mentioning that the media data space is not automatically a copyright data space. It's a data space for the media sector. And then how could we then ensure that we have synergies here is a question to address. But we have only a few minutes. Any comments yet? Other comments from the floor? I see none. I would like to just mention what I really enjoyed the most in Carlotta Denini's and also David Humphrey's speeches was the mentioning of listening to the authors and the creators themselves who feel that they have not been listened to, and that the data, ability to know and use their data is really a key ingredient in this process in order for them to integrate with the infrastructures that are being developed. So this is something that normally maybe is not acknowledged or thought that they don't want to know about the data. For instance, the creators, they don't want to and they don't have the capacity to know about the data. But we feel also in Finland, as David mentioned, it's really important to educate the authors and creators to understand the value of data for them. And it's actually my data. It's a self-sovereign identity issue. So basically everyone will be addressed with self-sovereign identities sooner or later. And that is actually the basis for the action of creative individuals on the internet. I would say that it's going to happen. So my data is one kind of a service component in the data infrastructure and in the data economy that will bring not only benefits for the creators and the individuals, but also for data intermediaries who help the use of data and sharing of data in the data economy for benefit of the broader audiences. But that's, I think, this was the two comments that I wanted to make, but I think we can continue in another setting, hopefully some other time. These were two first global workshops, and I'm really glad that so many of you participated, especially the speakers and Benoit Miller from WIPO and all the people who shared your views. Thank you so much. And this is the recording will be put on the portal and also available on the ministry's website. So you can check it from there later on and share it with your colleagues who did not, for instance, be able to participate. I think with these words, I'm ready, and I think we can stop the meeting here. I hope that you enjoyed this workshop, and feel free to send me any information that you would like to share in the dialogue portal. The dialogue portal is really important. It's a platform to access any information on project related to copyright infrastructure, and it's open to everyone, so it's available online, so everybody can join and find out information related to copyright infrastructure.
Thank you very much for inviting me, and it was really interesting. So,
bye-bye. Great. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much.
Have a nice weekend, and we have the Labor Day party. Very small. We are not going to. We are not going to have big
Thank
parties.
Thank you, everyone.
Small
Thank
parties.
You.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.